What's up?
Recall that on chromosome 9 located JAK2 gene that encodes JAK2 kinase. The function of JAK2 kinase is to activate cellular pathways that are responsible for cellular proliferation, mostly of myeloid cells, and activation of pathways occurs by phosphorylation. By activation of JAK-STAT pathway, JAK2 kinase stimulate mostly red blood cells production. By activation of PI3K/AKT pathway, it stimulates the production of megakaryocytes from which platelets are formed. By activation of RAS pathway, it stimulates the production of granulocytes and monocytes. And in normal condition, JAK2 kinase is active only when it receives signal by cytokines. Kidneys produce erythropoietin that stimulates red blood cells production. Liver produces thrombopoietin that stimulates production of megakaryocytes from which platelets are formed. And bone marrow microenvironment by secretion of granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor cause increase in production of granulocytes and monocytes. But if mutation causes substitution of valine on phenylalanine in 617 position of JAK2 kinase, now JAK2 kinase becomes constantly activated, so this regulation by cytokines is gone, and this mutation causes disproportional activation of intracellular pathways that results in mild increase in granulocytes and monocytes, moderate increase in platelets, and severe increase in red blood cells. With increase in red blood cells, hemoglobin concentration and hematocrit will also proportionately increase, and erythropoietin concentration will proportionately decrease. And the diagnosis of polycythemia is made based on increase in red blood cells, hemoglobin and hematocrit, panmyelosis with pleomorphic megakaryocytes, based on the presence of a mutation or mutated JAK2 kinase, and low erythropoietin level.
Stars crashing down, and what are they putting in bananas these days?
Now, why increase in red blood cells is so dangerous? First of all, red blood cells constitute 99% of all cells in the blood. Because if we compare the normal value of red blood cells, let's say 4.5 multiply on 10 to the power of 12, and normal value of white blood cells, which is 4.5 multiply on 10 to the power of 9, we see that the amount of red blood cells is 1000 times higher compared to white blood cells or any other cell in the blood.
Come on, think about it.
So, because red blood cells are the most abundant cells in the blood, with increase in red blood cells, blood viscosity increases the most. So, in polycythemia, blood becomes extremely viscous, and this creates problems. Increase in blood viscosity causes decrease in blood flow through the entire cardiovascular system. Recall that blood flow through the vessel is equal to pressure difference between two points of the vessel divided on resistance. And resistance is directly proportional to the viscosity and length of the vessel and indirectly proportional to the radius of the vessel. So with increase in viscosity, resistance to flow increases, and with increase in resistance, blood flow will decrease. The major problem is that with decrease in blood flow, the risk of venous thrombosis increases. Recall that we have so-called Virchow triad, and according to Virchow triad, decrease in blood flow, or so-called stasis of the blood, is one of the major three criteria that contribute to deep ventricular thrombosis. So in polycythemia vera, because the amount of red blood cells is huge, blood viscosity is high, so the risk of deep ventricular thrombosis is very significant. Most common sites of deep ventricular thrombosis are lower extremities and hepatic or portal veins. Thrombosis of hepatic vein, also called Budd-Chiari syndrome, and with time it can cause hepatomegaly. And thrombosis of portal vein, with time, can cause splenomegaly. The most sensitive system to any alterations in the blood flow is neural system. Decrease in blood flow in retinal circulation can cause visual disturbances. And decrease in blood flow in cerebral circulation can cause symptoms as headache or lightheadedness.
What are the signs of a stroke? I can't feel my tits!
With increase in red blood cells, total blood volume increase, and the increase in total blood volume cause hypertension. The concept is that the volume of blood that flows through the vessels has hydrostatic pressure that acts in all directions, including blood vessel wall. And when we measure blood pressure, we measure exactly the hydrostatic pressure that acts on blood vessel wall. And the concept is that the higher the blood volume, the higher is the hydrostatic pressure of the blood. To understand this, we have to know that the hydrostatic pressure of fluid is equal to the weight of fluid that acts on some area. And weight is equal to mass of fluid multiplied on gravity constant. And mass is equal to fluid density times fluid volume. So now we see that in polycythemia, increase in red blood cells cause increase in blood volume. The higher the blood volume, the higher the hydrostatic pressure of blood, thereby the higher will be the force that acts on blood vessel wall. As a result, the higher will be the blood pressure that we measure. So in polycythemia, with increase in total blood volume, hypertension develops. Also important that decrease in blood flow and increase in plasma volume cause tissue swelling, especially at peripheral regions. So to explain this, cardiovascular system is a closed system where fluid exchange occurs in capillaries, because capillaries have pores. So we have arterial circulation that delivers blood to capillaries, we have veins that provide outflow blood from capillaries, and we have capillaries that have pores. Through these pores and capillaries, fluid with nutrients can enter to the interstitial space. From the interstitium, cells that compose a particular tissue receive vital substances. But some portion of fluid after this remains in the interstitium. And then lymphatic system drains the excess fluid from the interstitial space into the venous system. So it's a general picture.
Now what?
The amount of fluid that cross capillaries and enters to the interstitium depends on filtration rate. And filtration rate is described by Starling equation. Filtration rate is equal to hydrostatic pressure difference between capillaries and interstitium minus oncotic pressure difference between capillary and interstitium, and directly proportional to the hydraulic conductivity. The major force that pushes fluid out of the vessel is hydrostatic pressure difference. The factor that keeps fluid inside the vessel is oncotic pressure difference, and hydraulic permeability describes how permeable are capillaries. The major factor that determines filtration rate is hydrostatic pressure inside the capillary, and hydrostatic pressure is determined by the fluid volume inside the capillary, because as we already know, the higher the blood volume, the higher the hydrostatic pressure, and in polycythemia, we have a number of factors that increase the volume of blood in capillaries. Thereby, hydrostatic pressure difference will increase, so the higher will be the amount of fluid that goes from capillaries to the interstitium. So what are the factors? We have to know that the inflow of blood to capillaries is determined by the cardiac output. And cardiac output is a stroke volume multiplied on heart rate. In polycythemia, increase in red blood cells cause increase in total blood volume. Thereby the high will be the stroke volume and thereby cardiac output. So the high will be the fluid inflow to capillaries, so the high will be the volume of blood in capillaries. The outflow of blood from capillaries is equal to pressure difference divided on resistance, and resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. In polycythemia, increase in red blood cells cause increase in viscosity of blood, so resistance increase. With increase in resistance, flow decrease. And also in polycythemia, there is a significant risk of deep venous thrombosis. And if thrombosis occurs, then radius will decrease, thereby resistance will increase and blood outflow will decrease. The lower the outflow from capillaries, the higher will be the volume of blood inside the capillaries. The higher the volume of blood, the higher is the hydrostatic pressure of blood. So the higher will be the filtration rate. So hydrostatic pressure basically push fluid from capillaries into the interstitial space. And at some point, fluid income to the interstitial space will prevail over lymphatic drainage. So fluid will accumulate in the interstitium, and accumulation of fluid in the interstitial space causes tissue swelling, or we can say it caused edema.
Did you understand a single word of what he just said?
With increase in red blood cells in polycythemia, the concentration of hemoglobin increase. And hemoglobin is the substance that determines the color of our blood. The higher the hemoglobin concentration, the more intense is the red color of the blood. And in polycythemia, the accumulation of so intensely red blood color in capillaries causes redness of the skin. In fact, when a person incomes to hematology department, sometimes you can even visually tell that a person has polycythemia based on the color of the skin. So in polycythemia, we have tissue swelling and redness of the skin, and together we call this plethoric complexion. So plethoric complexion in polycythemia characterized by two major features, its swelling and skin redness. Also with increase in red blood cells, spleen has to work harder. As a result, so-called work hypertrophy of the spleen develops, that results in splenomegaly. To explain this, recall that the major function of the spleen is filtration of the blood. This filtration is provided by splenic macrophages that consume old red blood cells. The problem in polycythemia is that the amount of red blood cells greatly increase. Thereby, more blood with red blood cells income to the spleen, so spleen has to do more work. And in response to this, to provide adequate filtration, spleen has to become bigger. Enlargement of the spleen called hypertrophy, and because this hypertrophy is related to increase in workload, such condition called work hypertrophy. So the analogy of this is muscle growth in bodybuilders. The higher the workload, the bigger become the muscles. The same story with the spleen. The more red blood cells income, the bigger becomes the spleen. It's just the adaptive mechanism. Another type of cells that increase in polycythemia are basophils. Basophils have a lot of histamine inside them, and basically mutation makes basophils to a certain extent hyperactive. So basophils begin to release more histamine into the blood, and histamine stimulates parietal cells to release hydrochloric acid, and increase in secretion of hydrochloric acid greatly increases the risk of gastrointestinal ulcers. Also with increase in basophils, the amount of mast cells in the tissue increase. We still do not know yet are basophils are precursors of mast cells or not, but we know that increase in basophils in the blood is associated with increase in mast cells in the tissues. Mast cells also have a lot of histamine inside them, and in polycythemia they also become hyperactive. The major difference is that mast cells live in tissues, and in polycythemia when person takes hot shower, hot water can trigger the release of histamine from mast cells, and this can cause severe pruritus. Because this pruritus is triggered by hot shower, we call this aquagenic pruritus, and such pruritus can become really annoying.
I've got a little itch down there. Would you mind?
So in polycythemia, hot water can cause aquagenic pruritus, which is really a signature feature of this disease. Also, the amount of malignant megakaryocytes increase. With increase in megakaryocytes, platelets production increase. With increase in amount of platelets, the risk of arterial thrombosis greatly increase. This can cause stroke or myocardial infarction, but the most signature feature of polycythemia is that microvessel thrombosis can occur, that manifests with erythromelalgia. Erythromelalgia is a burning, painful sensation in hands or feet with warmth of the extremities and erythema of the fingers. It actually looks close to this. To explain this briefly, there is arterial vessel, and blood vessels have nociceptive receptors. One of such receptors are the voltage-gated sodium channel. And usually, if endothelial injury occurs, platelets come to the site of injury then adhesion and aggregation occurs, and all this results in formation of a small platelet plaque, from which secondary hemostasis makes thrombus. But in polycythemia or essential thrombocytosis, platelet count become extremely high. And generally, the higher the platelet count, the more active become primary hemostasis. So now, in response to endothelial injury, because the amount of platelets become higher, platelets will form significantly bigger platelet plaque, from which a secondary hemostasis will form a much bigger thrombus. The major problem is that a bigger thrombus will cause obstruction of the blood vessel, and obstruction will cause decrease in blood flow through this region. Because recall that with decrease in radius, resistance increase, and with increase in resistance, blood flow decrease. As a result, fluid begin to accumulate proximal to the obstruction. Increase in fluid volume will cause over-distension of the vessel wall, and the distension of the vessel wall stimulate nociceptive receptors. Nociceptive receptors send this signal as electric stimulus, and their significant stimulation will cause electric stimulus that will reach a threshold of excitation, and this will provoke an action potential, and depolarization of nociceptive receptors triggers pain. Pain will provoke vasodilation, so blood will inflow to the affected region, so the higher will be the volume of arterial blood, and this will cause erythema and worms. Also, because blood flow to peripheral regions becomes disrupted, this will cause ischemia of peripheral tissues. First of all, ischemia will cause pain, and in severe cases, prolonged ischemia can cause formation of distal ulcers. Mutation in polycythemia provokes progressive increase in platelets production, and the problem is that severe increase in platelets production forces bone marrow to produce broken platelets. Recall that first of all, to provide functions, platelets require surface receptors, HGP1B or GP2B3A and COX enzyme. Without them, adhesion and aggregation becomes impossible. And when bone marrow produces such great amount of platelets in a hurry, sometimes platelets are produced broken, without one of these essential components. And without any of them, they are incapable to provide effective primary hemostasis. Disrupted primary hemostasis increases the risk of bleeding. Recall that disruption of primary hemostasis manifests with prolongation of the bleeding time, so in routine life, after cuts for example, bleeding lasts longer than normal. The major feature is mucous membrane bleeding. It's bleeding from GI tract, during menstruation, in addition to this they have bleeding gums and nose bleeding, so-called epistaxis. Also, disruption of primary hemostasis causes microhemorrhages that on skin manifest with petechiae purpura ecchymosis. So the more severe becomes polycythemia, the higher becomes the platelets production, the more platelets are produced broken, the higher is the risk of bleeding.
Okay. Fine. Yep.
Ciao!
What's that mean?
I need to tell you. Someone's had a dream.